Good evening. My name is Bob O'Callaghan. I'm the president and CEO of the Wyoming Kentwood Area Chamber of Commerce. And tonight we're in the studios of WKTV. We're holding our annual candidate forums, and tonight's a primary edition. We're so glad you're with us. We really appreciate the opportunity for the candidates to be able to let the voters know how they stand on the issues. Our moderator tonight is Kathy Beatty. She's a board member of the Wyoming Kentwood Chamber. She owns her own business and is an accomplished speaker, and she also is an account manager for Priority Health. And I'll introduce Kathy now. Kathy?
Thank you, Bob. Good evening. Welcome to the Wyoming Kentwood Chamber of Commerce Candidate Forum. We are going to be speaking with candidates for the 28th District State Senate. We have with us Kevin Green and candidate Pete McGregor. So we welcome you and thank you for joining us. I'd like to explain maybe a little elementary, but the definition of what a state senator does. A state senator, the job of a state senator is to create and pass legislation that will benefit the citizens of his or her district, as well as the entire state. To do this, state senators must work within their committees and form relationships with senators who have different political views. Negotiating is a major part of a state senator's job. They must debate and persuade other senators to support or oppose particular legislation. State senators serve two-year terms. I would like to begin this evening with a three-minute introduction from both of our candidates. I will begin with candidate Green.
Actually, it's a four-year term.
Oh, I'm sorry.
It's a four-year term.
Thank you.
So, good evening, everyone. I'd like to thank WKTV and Kathy and Bob for having us tonight and sponsoring this for all the candidates. Most everyone here knows who I am. I'm Kevin Green, and I represented this area for 11 years as a city councilman, as a state representative, and also as the chair of the Wyoming-Kentwood Area Chamber of Commerce. As your elected official, I was known for customer service, for being very responsive and accessible to my citizens and the residents of Wyoming and Byron Township. As the Republican whip during the Granholm years, I was able to build consensus and get many things done, which could be very difficult in the minority party. Recently, I finished my master's degree in public administration from Grand Valley State University. I'm a small business owner. I own a mobile home park. And I'm a single father, raising two beautiful kids, a 4 and 5. That's the toughest job I have. I'm running for state senate because I'm concerned with our government being out of control. The people are getting sick and tired of what's going on at all levels of government. And I want to be your state senator to make a difference and make sure that the residents and businesses here prosper. One of the biggest problems our state faces is indifference and obstructive control that the government is basically trying to take over our lives. I've been going door to door talking to our residents to see firsthand the challenges that they all face. I hear the same thing over and over, enough is enough. My goal is to bring accountability and responsiveness to all departments within state government. It is mind-boggling to me that the state legislature left for summer vacation and didn't even pass legislation to fix our crumbling roads. As the former whip of the party, I never would have let that happen. Providing proper roads and infrastructure is essential to driving our economy forward. My ultimate goal is for Michigan to be known as the model state for small business. If we engage with our business and inspire our workforce, we can have a better future. Thank you again, Kathy and Bob, for having us today.
Thank you. Candidate McGregor.
Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. Thank you to the Wyoming Kentwood Chamber of Commerce. Kathy and Bob, thank you for the invite and the opportunity and everyone's time. I'm Peter McGregor, and I've been married for 23 years to Christine. I have three sons, Patrick, John, and Matthew. I'm a former small business owner, employing 12 people, and I'm also a former township supervisor and currently serving as the state representative for the 73rd district. 4 years ago, when I first took office, our state was in a huge mess. We had a $1.5 billion deficit, and our economic conditions were dead last. We had lost 750 to 800,000 jobs over the last decade, the lost decade, I like to call it. We're just coming out of the greatest recession that we've ever had in the last decade. Almost a million people have left our state. We lost population. We're the only state in the whole nation that actually lost population. I attribute this to failed policies of the Granholm and the past legislatures, and believe that the budget gimmicks that they tried to implement, the out-of-control spending, as well as the kick-the-can-down-the-road type of leadership, are the reasons that our state was in a world of hurt. I decided, to help with my wife and my family, that I would leave the private sector because I could no longer sit by and watch the state that I love go down the drain. And it's not only for the sake of our hardworking taxpayers, but it's also for the sake of the children, our future for our children. So I decided to get involved. I saw myself, and I continue to see myself, as a new breed of legislator who is reform-minded and result-oriented. The status quo of tax and borrow had to stop. I use a motto in the private sector, and it's called listen, commit, deliver. And I have continued to use this model as a legislator, and I continue to serve by this code. As a state legislator and a state rep, I have reduced my pay, increased my co-pays, and eliminated lifetime legislator health care benefits. These are the real results of leadership in Lansing right now. This is good for you because your tax dollars have accountability and the performance measures attached to it right now. Just like you, government needs to right-size itself. Just like you, we need to pay off our debts. And just like you, we need to continue to save for our rainy day fund. As the next state senator, I will continue to fight for the hardworking taxpayers, and I will continue to provide results. It's about you, our community, and our future of our children. Thank you, Kathy.
Thank you very much. We will begin with a question in which each candidate has 1 minute to respond. I will begin with candidate Green. What keeps your constituents up at night?
Well, I've been going door to door for the last couple months, and the number one concern is the roads. They're very, very frustrated that nothing has been done with the roads. The other day I spent $368 on my wheel bearings, and so that was just one wheel bearing. Now the other one's going bad, and so they're getting frustrated because we're paying for the cost and not getting any results. The solution is there. We have the sales tax on gas, 6%, brings in about $1 billion a year, and none of that goes to the roads. Right there would solve a big portion of the problem.
Thank you. Candidate McGregor.
Yeah, the question is, what keeps up
the constituents
I have? Mm-hmm. There's a couple things. I would agree that roads is either 1A or 1B. And we have dedicated existing resources in a package of bills that the House sent over to the Senate. So when Kevin had mentioned that he would not adjourn, the House had no control over the Senate, whether they adjourn or not. We sent over a package that would put almost $500 million into the roads right now. It was revenue neutral. It was using existing resources. We are coming up with solutions, and it's tough to get the other side of the chambers to agree with us. The other one is our debt. We have a huge amount of debt. We've eliminated $20 billion of that debt so far. We still have about $56 billion of unfunded liabilities right now in the state.
Thank you. Well, you must have known what my next question is. I'm going to keep it anyway, which is roads. Why can't we come up with a long-term solution for our roads with our infrastructure being so foundational? Why isn't this resolved sooner than less relevant issues?
Well, roads have been a problem for probably 30 years. We haven't done anything for roads for 30 years. We had a tax increase in 1998 with no COLA indicator to it. So this problem isn't new. I wish we had a silver bullet and we could actually fix it right now. But the problem is we can't fix this overnight. We put forward a thoughtful road funding reform package to the Senate that would put almost $500 million that would be ongoing right now over to the Senate. This would be the first of many solutions. I think we got to eat this elephant one bite at a time. I don't think we need to raise taxes this time. I would think we need to actually use the money that we have within. And I think this first package was a very good, thoughtful package.
Candidate Green.
The federal government gives us a 1-to-4 match for road funding. So for every dollar we raise, it brings in an additional $4 at the federal level. The state has a $50 billion budget. Of that, about $10 billion is in the general fund that is has some discretion. So we just have to prioritize the money we have. Again, if we just took the sales tax, so the 6% sales tax on gas, it would bring in $1 billion a year. And right now, none of that money is going to the roads. Most other states have their sales tax go to road funding. So there's the answer. Now, nothing is easy, as Mr. McGregor said. But the reality is then we have to look at, do we fund some of those other programs? Do we cut some of those other programs? But to not dedicate sales tax on roads for roads is just ridiculous. So.
Thank you. Candidate Green, what is the government's role in same-sex marriage?
Well, I personally believe that marriage is between one man and one woman. That's my belief system. We did pass a constitutional amendment a few years ago that the people voted to have that in the Constitution as well.
Candidate McGregor?
I would agree. Being married now for 23 years to my wife, Christine, it is in my core principles and my core beliefs. This is why I think people vote for me, is because I have these solid beliefs that marriage is between a man and a woman. So I would have to agree with Candidate Green on that one.
Okay. How do we resolve the $1 trillion school debt? What is the government's responsibility?
Well, it kind of goes along with our roads. We have, Candidate Green had mentioned that we have 6% sales tax at the pump. Little does do a lot of people know that 4% by constitution goes to the schools. The problem we have is we made some sweetheart deals in the 70s, 80s, and 90s for health care and for retirement benefits and pensions, and now it's coming to roost. We spend close to 30% of payroll just to pay for the liabilities that we have within our schools. That's money that's not getting to the classrooms. So we have pretty much reformed any ongoing liabilities. We've addressed, like I said earlier, $20 billion of reforms. And we still have a long way to go. We will be out of debt if we stay on track in 2038.
Candidate Green?
Well, I have every vested interest to make sure the school systems are sound. I have a 4-year-old that's in preschool, and I have a 5-year-old that's in kindergarten. And they mean everything to me. So to not make sure that the schools are sound is absolutely important. I mean, this is the children only get 1 year to take each class, and if they don't get educated properly, then we're in big trouble in the future. I back a proposal called Classrooms and Kids that would actually take money from some of the programs we have and put it into the foundation allowance. Right now, most of the schools get about $7,200 per pupil in funding. And some of the schools get up to $13,000 per school. So we need to get rid of that disparity and have a level playing field. When I was a legislator, we actually started to
Thank
do
you
that.
Very much. Candidate Green, a truck weight in Michigan, does it need to be lowered for our roads?
You know, I don't think so, actually. Maybe that's not the answer people want to hear, but I believe in the free market, and I think it's important that the companies be allowed to get their product to Michigan in the cheapest way possible. There has to be some limitations, but I don't think we need to lower those. There's a lot of ways that you can fix the roads, and if you do them properly, they should be able to sustain the weight. of the truck. So.
Thank you. Candidate McGregor?
Yeah, I don't think it's the weight that is the problem, because then we spread the weight out per axle in the state of Michigan. I think the problem going forward with our roads is the quality of roads. A lot of times we go with the cheapest quality because it's government work. We could get rid of the cheapest if we got rid of prevailing wage. We could actually spend some more money on our roads. But the package of bills that I said that we sent over to the Senate had some interesting issues in there regarding warranties, because we were going to start to make our road builders warranty the roads. So I really think it's the quality of the roads, the quality of the seams in the roads that are causing a lot of our problems.
Thank you. Candidate McGregor, could you give us an incident in your professional life when you worked with someone of extreme opposite belief and how you worked together to achieve a good outcome?
Okay. Professional life, could it be my legislative life too?
Is sure.
That kind of because I don't consider this my professional life. I had owned a business for 14 years. But I have a great example. I had a package of bills regarding use tax with a company right here in Grand Rapids, American Seating. Treasury and the leaders of Treasury, being part of the same party, you would think that we could get a package of bills through with no problem. But it took me almost 18 months to convince the Department of Treasury that they were double taxing one of our best employers in the state of Michigan. They were assessing use tax right when it got on the truck. Well, you know, we went around full circle, and finally by the end, Treasury realized what they were doing. It's because they weren't willing to listen, and that's all I ask, is to have people listen. Sometimes it takes a whole lot more courage to sit down and listen than it does to stand up and yell out.
Candidate Green?
I have two examples. When I was the chair of the Chamber of Commerce, we actually passed the bylaws for the Chamber of Commerce, and it was challenging, to say the least. I felt like I was working on the U.S. Constitution, because everybody had a different opinion. And we got it done, and we feel very proud of that, that there's some structure now. The other one is I worked on some stillbirth legislation, and I'm very pro-life, but a lot of my colleagues on the Democratic side are pro-choice. And I actually passed it out of the House with a near unanimous vote to educate parents on what they can do to prevent a stillbirth. So. Was passed out of the House nearly unanimously, and so I had to work very closely with the other side of the aisle and work through those issues.
Thank you. In education, why would you move the responsibility for testing students from the Department of Education to the Department of Treasury? And are there legitimate concerns of the Education Department that cannot be addressed in other ways?
I don't personally believe it's necessary to move it to the Department of Treasury. More importantly than which department it falls under is making sure we don't take away local control. You know, I've met with many teachers, many school board members, many principals, superintendents, and their biggest frustration is that we're taking control, that we're always interfering with what they're doing, we're always giving them more and more requirements, we're giving them more and more tests, so they don't have control to do what they think is right. And I think that's what made our state and country great, is that we have different choices. So that way, if a parent doesn't like a certain school system, they can move to a different one. One thing I didn't like that the legislature has been working on and passing is what's called core curriculum. And what it does is it standardizes the core curriculum for all of the different schools. And I personally think that's a bad idea.
Candidate.
Yeah, I think your question comes about because of the lack of accountability and transparency that the Department of Education is willing to provide the state legislature. We've been asking for more accountability and measurements from the Department of Education, and because they are constitutionally autonomous from us, we're having a tough time working with them. Giving this responsibility to Department of Treasury, after my last example that I just explained to you about some of the issues I had, I think it may be going from the pot to the frying pan with them. But it was in the Department of Treasury a few years back. I don't think that is the solution. I think the solution is holding the people in the Department of Education accountable as well as making sure that they are accountable to the legislator as well.
Speaking of, still on education, thank you. 40 states, including Michigan, have adopted the Common Core. Is this a fundamental change that we need to improve the skills of the students? And what trustworthy source has convinced us of this? And if not this, then what can help us speed up our students to the rest of the world?
Right. Common Core is basically a set of standards. That's how it started. It's gotten blown up into we're taking away the rights of the locals. I don't want to take away any rights of in having that local control. Some of our school systems here in West Michigan, the school systems that I have represented, do an awesome job. They're the experts. I go to them for this. I've talked to private schools, public schools, charter schools, our business community. All of them seem to like this set of standards. We just have to make sure that our student privacy and that we continue to have local control are part of the issue and part of the talking.
Candidate Green.
I guess this is one area I do disagree with my opponent. I don't think core curriculum is a good way to go. Everything going on with the federal government today, it's scary. It's absolutely scary. They're very intrusive in our lives. I don't trust them having control of our curriculum for our students. They've taken a lot away, a lot of rights of all of us in general. And it's just a dangerous thing that we need to be aware about. So I will do everything I can not to have that pass, because I just don't think it's a good thing for us.
Thank you. Immigration in Michigan, what should be our stance? And what are your thoughts of the children who are sent without parents into the U.S.?
It's an issue we don't deal with a ton at the state level. That's more of a federal issue. But I did work closely with Dave Ajima on some of his e-verification that he got close to passing. He never did get it passed. But it what it does is that the employers would have to check if they're an illegal or a legal immigrant. It would be one way to verify. Right now, we don't have any of that system in place, and I really think it needs to happen. So,
okay.
Yeah, this is a tough issue just because it's more of a federal issue. Until our federal government gets their act together, it's going to be tough to deal with immigrant issues in here. In fact, sounds like Representative or Kevin Green actually worked with Dave Ajima. Dave Ajima and I actually got the e-verification in many of the budgets. So it's happening right now moving forward. This is something that until we get the federal government on the right page and come up with real solutions, it's going to trickle down to the states and cause many problems.
Could you tell me what bills that are currently proposed do you support or are you against?
What bills?
Mm-hmm. Any that are currently proposed?
There's hundreds of bills.
Pick your favorite.
Wow. Well, I have a couple bills out there that I support. I have an ombudsman bill that I've been working on now for two sessions. This ombudsman bill is designed to put an ombudsman, independent ombudsman, in our veterans' home in Grand Rapids. This is someone that he's not beholden to the administration, he's not beholden to the governor. He reports back to the legislature. Right now, I think it's someone that they need a voice there in our Grand Rapids home. I think I've pushed for that for quite a long time. They're kind of doing the ombudsman on the internal side. So that would be one that I support. I sit on appropriation, so I support a lot of the reforms that we've gone on appropriations. A lot of, in my budget, I chair the Department of Human Services, and over the past 2 years, I have been able to cut $1.3 billion in that department, and still make sure that we take care
Thank
of our children.
Thank you. Candidate Green?
In my 6 years in office, I voted on 5,400 pieces of legislation. Which is astounding. It's way too many. If I'm blessed to be elected, I definitely will look at the laws and try to fix as many as possible, get rid of as many as possible. I don't think we need to create too many more new laws, but definitely I would work on fixing the tax tribunal. It's a very slow process. So a lot of our businesses, they try to fight their taxes because they think they were assessed improperly. And it can take up to 2 years for them to actually get the results back. And they have a business to run. They need to be focusing on their business, not worrying about did they get the correct taxes assessed to them. So it's one area I definitely want to promote. I also support the personal property tax exemption, which is on the ballot. So please vote yes on that issue.
So. Thank you. Can you tell us what is your greatest personal and legislative accomplishment?
As the whip of the party, it was my job to shepherd my colleagues' conservative bills. And it was a difficult time because we did serve in the minority, which means the other party had control, and we also served under a Democratic governor. So for us to be able to, we actually passed the budget with our colleagues, with the state Republicans, which was amazing because we didn't have the votes. But because we stuck together, it was my job to build consensus, to stick together. We actually cut the budget all 4 years I was there. All 4 years I was there. One of the years we actually cut the budget 25%, and we, you know, we're very careful about cutting services. I mean, you always have to be careful. I mean, cuts aren't necessarily a good thing unless you're trying to get rid of make it more efficient if there's duplication of services. So that's my biggest accomplishment is actually working and getting my colleagues to pass good legislation.
Candidate McGregor.
Probably my biggest accomplishment. I have four of them. And it's the passing the four structurally balanced budgets 4 months ahead of time, 4 years in a row. It's quite an accomplishment. It helps out our local schools, our local communities to be able to budget. They don't always like what the amount of money that we're sending them, but at least they know how much we're getting. There was plenty of times in the Granholm era where they had to stop the clock at midnight on September 30th, or actually take money back because they couldn't get their numbers right in the first place. So I think our structurally balanced budget, cutting $1.5 billion out of the budget that first year that I was in office, those are some huge accomplishments.
Who is supporting you and why are you running for this seat?
Who is supporting me? Current Senator Jansen, his seat is the 28th seat right now. He isn't supporting me. Representative Tom Hooker is also supporting me. I just received the endorsement of the Grand Rapids Chamber of Commerce. I received the endorsement of Right to Life, the Grand Rapids Association of Realtors. So I also received the endorsement of the Michigan Chamber of Commerce. These are a lot of strong organizations. A lot of your members in the Wyoming Chamber are also members of the Grand Rapids Chamber and the Michigan Chamber. I also have the endorsement of many of our local leaders here in West Michigan, all the legislators that are in the House. The second part of the question was,
why are you running?
Why am I running? Because we're not done. We have come a long way over the past 3 years. We have reduced the amount of regulations. We've reduced 1,950 pieces of regulations so far. And that means we've reduced it 10 for every one that we've gone up.
Candidate Green?
Well, I have the endorsement of Right to Life, which is very important to me. I mean, there's no issue that's near and dear to my heart is the saving lives. I chose this time to actually just get the endorsement of the people. Mr. McGregor, very impressive with his list of endorsements. He's the establishment candidate. I am a little bit more of a rebel. I want to, you know, get out there and shake things up. And in order to do that, I don't feel beholden in any way to anybody by getting endorsed. I'm free to do what I think is right, and the people is what matters to me. I want the people's vote, and I've been knocking on doors. I've knocked on over 8,000 doors to get people to endorse me.
Thank you. Why is right to work important for our state?
Well, right to work allowed people to choose whether they want to be in a union or not. There's a freedom of choice. I know I've talked to many of the unions, and it's upsetting to them because they don't have the same leverage they used to in contract negotiations. And they feel that if you get the benefit of a union, you should be paying a member. But it was passed, and I'm not sure what the results have been yet, as far as has it improved the economy or not.
Thank you. Excuse me. McGregor.
Yeah, it's a great question. Right to work or freedom of choice. I had the privilege of pressing the green button for right to work. I was in office when we passed this. It was quite a piece of legislation that I'm very proud to stand behind. I think the relevant questions that we want to ask ourselves is, how does this impact unemployment, and how does it impact our wages? And all the facts that you read nowadays, our unemployment is up. Our wages are the highest they've ever been since 2008. So right-to-work states are outperforming those states that have the closed union doors.
Thank you very much, gentlemen. At this time, we will allow you to have a three-minute wrap-up. You may touch on any of these topics or those that are of more concern to you. And we will begin with Candidate McGregor.
Okay, thank you. I know competitor over here, Kevin Green, has talked about enough is enough that he's been hearing from the door. And I agree, enough is enough. But the problem isn't at the state of Michigan. The problem is our federal government. The state of Michigan has been doing quite a bit of reforming. Our unemployment rate when I took office was almost 12%. It's 7.4% now. We've gained over 250,000 private sector jobs. Our ranking last decade, when Kevin Green was in office, we were 49th and 50th in tax ranking in the GDP. We are now 14th and 6th in the nation. We have structurally balanced our budget. Like you at home, like you here in the audience, we are paying down our debt. We are start saving for the rainy day funds. And we continue to protect life, making sure that certain procedures like abortions are not being paid for with your tax dollars. We also maintain personal freedom, protecting your Second Amendment rights, and giving workers the freedom to choose. In closing, I would like to ask the voters to be informed and ask lots of questions. Review our voting records. We both have voting records. Ask any of your trusted business leaders or current elected leaders who they would like to team up with and who they are endorsing. Find out from people who you trust and who you respect who the best person is to work with. Please reach out to Senator Mark Jansen. Please reach out to Representative Tom Hooker. Talk to them. Ask them who they believe would be the most effective worker with them as the next senator. I would be honored to serve you as the next state senator, and I am humbly asking you for your vote on August 5th. Thank you, and God bless you.
Thank you. Candidate Green?
Well, when I was in office, I served under Jennifer Granholm, and I will admit that Governor Rick Snyder is a much better governor. I liked Ms. Granholm on a personal note, but we totally disagreed on issues. She actually vetoed more of our Republican legislation than all the governors before her. So it was a tad bit frustrating because there's definitely a lot of things that the governor passed, even Mr. McGregor passed, that I would have supported. But as a Republican, I'm very disappointed in some of the votes that the Republican-controlled House, Senate, and governor have passed. They voted for the pension tax. They voted for core curriculum. They voted for Medicaid expansion, which that we have no way to pay for in 3 years. They increased the minimum wage. They just bailed out Detroit for $200 million. And I want to tell you that it was the only bankruptcy I've ever seen that they didn't liquidate any assets. So how they could give them $200 million and not have them accountable in any way. Right now, Detroit is going to pay $250 million, which is over 60%, to the new Joe Louis Arena. And Detroit's not going to get any proceeds from them. They're not going to get any parking proceeds, any sales receipts, or no receipts from the event. So here, we just bailed them out for $200 million, and Detroit is going to give them $250 million. So there's no accountability, and it's just it's absurd. You know, I'm voting I'm sorry. I'm running because, I've had enough. I could sit back and not do anything, but I know I have the skill sets to make things happen. I was the whip of the party. It was my job to build consensus and get things done. Our United States Constitution gives us the right to life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Doesn't guarantee happiness, but the pursuit of happiness. The Constitution didn't give the government the right to be an intrusion in our lives. Our free market is what made our state and our country great. 95% of our taxes and most of our jobs are generated by our small businesses. We need to do everything we can to understand the businesses, support them, and give our job providers an opportunity to grow and prosper so that they can compete in the global economy. We need to keep our government lean, responsive, and accountable. I have been through many trials and tribulations in my life, and I know the value of God, family, and friends. I have a deep passion for helping other people. As a single father, I know the challenges of raising a family and making ends meet. As a small business owner, I understand the difficulties of thriving in this competitive market and the obstacles that government puts up along the way on a daily basis. I'm a pro-life, conservative Republican who has the experience, education, and passion to shake up things in Lansing. I can't do this without your support. I am very accessible and can be found at agreenlightforyou.com. Okay, maybe that's a little corny, guys, but
time.
You can even, oh.
Thank you very much to our candidates. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen, citizens, two of the candidates that are asking for your vote. We discussed a lot of very relevant, important issues, and hopefully you gained some information and got to know our candidates so that you can make an intelligent vote. We would ask that you join us with the Wyoming Kentwood Chamber getting involved with your government. We meet monthly at Kentwood City Hall and or at Wyoming City Hall, where we have legislators there that we approach with relevant topics, and we encourage you to get involved with us there or just get knowledge about your candidates. This is very important that we select the right people, put them in the right place. So with that, our thank you to WKTV, who always does an excellent job with us, our candidates for their valuable time and joining us, and for you, our participants here, and for the voters. Thank you and have a good evening.